Okay, we're back for our final session. It's been a great day so far. Let's finish strong. And right now, what we want to do, we really, you know, it's interesting. When you think about the climate change story as journalists in the visual medium, it's oftentimes more challenging than you would think. We like to have characters in our stories, and that's why we do so many stories on polar bears, you know. And there's a little more to it than polar bears, but the idea of the polar bear on the ice cube sinking is irresistible in television. So there's got to be more nuanced ways to tell this story, but also tell it in a compelling way that brings it home to people. And that, in our world, means usually involving some people who are affected, or in some cases, animals. But somehow telling a big story through the narrative, through the eyes of individuals or smaller stories is often the best way to go. So we're looking for ideas here on how to turn a big, colossal story into something that is engaging for people to make them understand it in a very meaningful way. So that's kind of a tough challenge, but I'll leave it to our final three guests here to deal with it. So let's begin with Per Espen Stoknes. He is a psychologist who, by the way, interesting statistic, the country which has more climate deniers than the United States, does anyone know what that country is? It is actually Norway. I read that, it was on CNN.com, it must be true, I don't know. So maybe true, a little truthiness to that, maybe. In any case, that really surprised me. Maybe Per can shed some light on that, but he also help us understand how that phrase, the deer in the headlights component, how we can get around that. Thank you, Per.
Thanks for inviting me. I'll take up the glove in terms of Norway, but wait a sec. So this is a presentation not about climate science, as we've had earlier today, but on how the science of how people respond to climate science. And there's a lot of interesting news there. Being both an economist and a psychologist, I tend to come at climate from a somewhat different angle. Before I kick it off, I'd like to, share a little personal story. What's driving me to look into this? And during the last 10, 15 years, I've been working closely with a friend called Jürgen Randers, who wrote the original book, The Mother of All Environmental Scares. It's called Limits to Growth, back in 1972, and we were having this fight. And he, after analyzing our behavior for 40 years, have come to the firm conclusion that humans are hopelessly short-term. It seems that we are, our genes are set up to bring down the planet with us. So is it the case that humans are inevitably short-term? That's the question that drives me. Can I prove him wrong, or will I have to capitulate and tell him he's right? I'd like to put the question in a more constructive way as well. What would it take? What kind of conditions are needed for humans to act for the long term in everyday life? And now I'm going to hand it over to you guys. What do you think, by the year 2100, humans have successfully solved the climate problem? Humans can solve the climate problem and will successfully do so? Or humans could solve the climate problem but are not going to, or it's very uncertain that it's going to. You have to choose between these two positions. And this is a test. And now everybody has to raise one arm for either or, and it's not allowed to do both, and it's not allowed to not vote, right?
What's the definition of solved?
That's in your interpretation. So humans can successfully solve the climate problem and will do so. It's very uncertain. Humans may be able to solve it, but are probably not going to. All right, everybody who is sure, who's uncertain that, or tend to the belief that doubtful that humans will solve it, hands up. Anybody taking a picture? I can't count anybody. Okay, thanks. And then I go over here. Who believes that humans will successfully solve the climate problem? Okay, so this is more in the region of 30%, I'd say, 30 to 70, in that area, okay? That's not a very, I wouldn't say those measurements are statistically reliable, but we're on the track. So I'll try after cocktail again. Right. So if it is the case that so many doubt that, why is that? How have we communicated climate that make people think this way? And what are the frames and the stories needed to actually turn it around? Let me break a little secret on you. It's easy to solve the climate problem. What you do? Well, you slam a price on carbon, and you use the proceeds to reinvest and educate women. So why don't we? Because, you know, science tells us it's getting increasingly urgent. And we had a wonderful temporal dimension and a perspective on this. And to get the perspective across, IPCC has given us this wonderful graph, which sums up 30, 40 years of evident research on the issue, showing that we're on our way on this red line towards a toast world in 2100, where it's about 4 degrees warmer Celsius or 8 degrees Fahrenheit. And to get the urgency and the importance of this curve across, they've given it the incredibly communicative name of RCP 8.5. Now, are you inspired? Or a big yawn, or laugh, I don't know. Because, you know, this is a toast world, this is global burning, this is like a crazy, insane place, and we call it RCP 8.5. We have another beautiful world, a world we can recognize, and that has the incredibly communicative name of RCP 2.6. And you're wondering why people don't care about climate. So what are we going to do? What effect has this curve has had on the American public? 25 years we've seen curves like this, and look closely at the effect. How much do you personally worry about the greenhouse effect or global warming? Back in the 1989, just after Jim Hansen broke the news for Congress in 1988 and created a stir, that man had balls. 6 or 7 out of 10 Americans were a fair amount or a great deal worried. And then after 25 years, we're down towards closer to 5. So, you know, there are also some specifics here in terms of countries, and now I'm getting back to you, Miles, that China, if you ask the question, the climate change we're currently seeing is largely the result of human activity. Well, the Chinese agrees, the Asians agree, the Latin American agree, but there are 3 countries at the bottom of this that actually says, we beg to differ. And you see, there are really 4 main dimensions in what we call climate attitudes. The first is it real? And Americans have got that. 63% of all Americans say it's real. Just 18% say it's not happening. Climate change is actually happening, global warming. But is it us? Well, 1/3 of people say no. And half say it's human caused. And then are we worried? Not very. 44% say it's nothing to worry about. And 55% say we are worried. And this is actually, Norwegians would agree completely that it's real, it's us, but Norwegians aren't very worried. We live far to the north, and we think, well, maybe a few degrees warmer would actually be pretty nice. And by the way, we have lots of oil, so, you know, it doesn't really worry us that much. But now comes the issue. 30% of you thought climate change were solvable, but what about what you think the American public believes? And this is where the problem lies. Look at that. 6% believe climate change is solvable. 82% say that humans are probably not going to solve this, which in psychology creates a backlash. Suddenly, since we can't solve it, I'm not going to worry much about it, and maybe it's not us after all. That's the psychology of this, and that's going to what to take you through. So how can it be that with the more certainty, the more scientific certainty we have, the less concern? That's the opposite of what a rational scientific mind an enlightened mind would believe. So in order to answer that question, I reviewed about 300 or 400 articles in the climate psychology area, sociology, social anthropology, and condensed that down to the 5 main defenses and the 5 solutions that we know work, evidence-based, as far as possible, and mixed in with some ideas. So if there is a climate message coming along, and you try to hit home to a person, The problem is that there are five layers, so to speak, that keep that message from working. So if you say, oh, we're above 400 ppms, oh, we've just crossed the threshold of 1 degree warming, 1 Celsius in the last 100 years, does that really hit home? Well, if you pass these five barriers, it would hit home. The first is a distance barrier. Distance is that a distance in time. I showed the graph I had with the year 2100. And honestly, when did you guys last make a decision for the next century? Second, it's far away. You mentioned polar bears. It's Arctic ice, it's glaciers, it's cyclones in the Pacific, etc. And fourthly, it's socially responsible and, social impacts are far away, and people responsible are somebody else, it's not me. So all these things create a psychological distance between me and the climate message. Then, second, if you pass that, if you say climate change is here and it's now, the next barrier is the doom barrier. And the doom barrier is a way to create guilt, fear, and kind of a very uncomfortable feeling that there's something wrong with me, I'm not doing the right stuff. And some media analysis showed that more than 80% of all articles in the media after IPCC launches were on the catastrophe or doom framing. So this huge overuse of the catastrophe framing to the expense of other framings. That was a study done by Oxford Institute of Journalism. Thirdly, if you get past the doom barrier, which makes people want to turn off, avoid, don't listen to, shut off the messenger, you would end up into the dissonance barrier. So when Carl here, for instance, in the second panel was talking about how nice it is with the animals and how beautiful they are, how intelligent they are, the first question he says always comes up, do you eat meat? Because people want to check for dissonance. Dissonance is when actions and knowledge doesn't quite match up. So that and a few friends of mine made a little film. So since you're media people, I'll explain what dissonance is. Oh, the video, please. No? OK, then we drop it. Or is it done? Wrong video. So dissonance is what happens when I know something and then I do something else. So this is me, I drive, I've taken a plane here to speak, and everybody else I know do the same thing. Yeah, you got it? Okay, shoot. Oh, that's the one. No. It was the other one, the one with the guy walking along. Do I get extra seconds for this? There we go. Is there sound to it as well?
Lucy Filet, I saw that Elon Musk was presenting a conference on the meat industry's contribution to climate change. That's when it hit me.
I had just gone home from dropping Preston a test prep to find my neighbor starting an eco remodel. They told me that my house was polluting 500 tons of carbon a year. Disgusting. That's when it hit me.
I was in my cruiser going to Whole Foods to get some snacks for me and my bros. I rolled up to my favorite spot right in front, and that's when it hit me. I had
cognitive dissonance.
So luckily, we're now launching a pill for this, because Americans love pills, right? It's called cogdisonex. So you can pop a pill and get rid of your cognitive dissonance. So switch back to the slides, please. Oh, there we go. Yeah, oops. So the problem with this is that this dissonance makes us want to not believe the facts. Because if I know that I have emissions and CO2 leads to climate chaos, then I feel bad about it, and I try to explain it away. So one way of doing that is say, well, you know, my emissions are really quite small. It's not me. My neighbor has a bigger SUV than me, and actually it's the Chinese. Or I could start to doubt one of them. So if I doubt that this one is real, you know, climate is actually always changing, then I get an immediate psychological payoff by feeling better. My cognitive dissonance goes away. Ah, it's not human caused after all. Or I can add additional cognition. I can say, well, I've installed solar on my roof, so my trip to Thailand doesn't really matter anymore. So we're good at self-justifications. And if this goes on for a while, we get into a permanent state of denial, which is not being stupid, ignorant, or immoral, or whatever, because it's overused as a pejorative. But really, being in denial is a case where you know something and live as if you do not know it at the same time. It's generated by the dissonance feeling, and after that, it's been parked as just a way of life. And finally, there's identity issue, which has to do with that our values, our self-perception, tends to override the facts. If the facts tell me my values are wrong, well, then there's something wrong with the facts. It's not something wrong with me. That's the easy part of it. So these are the main five barriers that keep people from engaging. And there's a little video here to sum them up before I go into the solutions. Shoot.
Distance between the audience and the crisis. The framing of doom and gloom creates fear, guilt, and avoidance of the issues. There is dissonance between how we feel about climate change and how we behave in everyday life. To get rid of blame and guilt, we sometimes deny there's even a problem. And lastly, our limited sense of self-identity has made climate change a political issue when it's actually not. For us to bring down these barriers, we have to understand the different parts of our psychology that determine how we think and behave.
Okay. So, how do we then break through these barriers, or maybe bypass them? Because I think these are actually key success criteria as well. Don't activate the barriers. We just go around them. And the way to do it is not by more reports and more facts. We have to employ strategies that go with our psychology, so to speak. So I've condensed these down into five strategies, and I'll focus on two of them, the supportive and the story. But just briefly, what does it mean to make climate social? Because we have to use people's faces and not like this typical thing, emphasize too much on glaciers, which people mostly haven't even been to. So how do we make it social? Well, you do that by using social norms, social media, making it local, just like we heard from Hunt Point and Elena was talking about, flow and glow, making it into a community issue and engaging people's social competitiveness. People like to compete with each other. It's a deeply socially evolutionary trait in the human species. So if you look, for instance, at solar panels, if there's one house that gets a solar panel on its roof, research shows that the likelihood of these houses also getting solar panels are way beyond the average of houses in the nation. So this is employing the power of social norms. Lots of things can be said about that. I want to focus now on the supportive framings. So how can we speak of this in a way that doesn't backlash on the issue? So first, just to remind you all what a frame is. I'm sure you've heard of George Lakoff. If he says, don't think of a pink elephant, which he loves to do at the audience. So don't think of a pink elephant, right? That's kind of hard. So you have to focus very, and if you try not to think of it, it kind of comes up anyway. And the same way, you know, pink elephants don't even exist. But in the same way, climate economists, climate people in the climate policy area have been speaking about how costly it is about to fix climate change. It's very expensive, it's so costly, we can't afford it, it kills jobs, etc. And even people who are more knowledgeable have to say it's not costly, like it's not a pink elephant. And therefore, we have been framed in this very destructive frame, which has kept back policy development. So we need to let that go and then rather speak of climate as a health issue. And I loved how Adam and Angela and Elena in the previous session spoke about how the health issue really got people going in the cities. So 7 million people die every year in the world from carbon pollution. 7 million people. In the US, it used to be about 13,000. Now it's around 10,000 people per year from air pollution itself. So respiratory diseases, heat-related stresses, pollen allergies, asthmas, etc., go way up there. But the solutions are also embedded in the health framing, because if we have more public transport, if we do more bikes, if we eat a bit less meat, all these things are good both for our health and for our climate. So these are the kind of issues that make it, people feel that this is personal, relevant, and urgent. What's killing me today? And what could I do to improve my health and the climate at the same time? So it's, research shows that this is one of the frames that actually increases people's support for the climate issue. Another important framing is insurance. Rather than speaking about uncertainty, scientists love their uncertainty bars, we should speak about how it's risk management, how we should take out an insurance policy of our own. So we should really do a kind of analysis about what does it take to actually take out a climate insurance policy. You know, today we pay about 3% of our income in fire and theft insurance. 3%. We don't need that much. We just need 1%. If we could rearrange 1% of our incomes as a climate insurance, taking out a climate insurance ourselves, then we could do some serious risk management. So as the bipartisan group of Paulson, Bloomberg, and Steyer put out last year, it's time to take out an insurance policy of our own. It is just plain, prudent, common sense to have a climate insurance. If we have a defense insurance in terms of a defense budget, we have fire insurance in terms of fire insurance, why don't we have a climate insurance? It's not costly, it's simply insurance. That's the story we should tell. And we avoid the damaging backlash effects of the cost framing, the pink elephants of the economist. Thirdly, my main and most, my favorite framing is the opportunity framing. And I think we should tell much more stories on the opportunities that climate bring. And I love this one story in particular. You might have heard of it, the solar panels. If you haven't, you should Google it and see their viral video. They have more than 20 million hits on their video. They got contributions from 165 different countries for their crowdsourcing, and they got 2.5 times more money than they asked for. People were throwing money at them. At the same time as economists were telling, this will never work, it's too expensive. What is it? It is solar panels below a level of hardened glass with a few LED lights in them. So you could make any kind of patterning on the road you'd want, and there's also some sensors. If people walk there, suddenly it lights up red. So what do we get? We have smartphones, we have smart houses. Why can't we have smart roads that actually produce more power than is needed for the car to run on it? People love the story. So point is, people are put off, feel constrained, their imaginations shut down by the catastrophe story. But if you open up to the opportunities, then they love it. Another example is, for instance, Tesla, who took a battery, the most boring product of all, and then made it into a design thing. And suddenly, they were selling more than they could produce before they were ready to produce it, just because people love it. I want one of those in my home. I want energy freedom. I want energy independence. You know, forget about government. Forget about utilities. I want the American dream is to be free, energy-free. It's an opportunity. This is the country of opportunity, isn't it? And freedom. Give it to me. And of course, I want a smart house. So Google is going into Nest to make smart thermostats. And the Chinese aren't far back behind. They're launching electric scooters, electric bikes. They're selling them by the bucket loads or by the million loads. 50 million electric scooters per year. Now it's almost 3 million electric scooters running on Chinese roads. Because cars jam up, but these go easily. So to sum up the framing discussion, what we need is more positive, supportive framings. What psychology research shows is that if you want people to be creative and active, you should have a ratio of 3-1 positive to negative framings. That's the optimum balance to release creativity and problem-solving attempts. This is empirically demonstrated in a lot of positive psychology studies. References in my book. Then stories. I've been looking into a series of stories that seem to engage people. And being an archetypal psychologist, I've been looking into what are the basic drivers, the basic myths underlying this. So if we're facing hell, what do we do? Do we sell the hell? What is it that really creates a narrative that makes a sense of community and meaning and wants people to get up? Well, we have to sell the dream. And there hasn't been much selling of that dream. hasn't been any descriptions of what a really energy efficient, climate friendly, human friendly society and city looks like. So we have to describe that. And I love the pictures we saw from Hunts Point where you had this, think about the future. I saw the lady there. And I think the new story is that we are going to solve this because it's simply smart. It's much smarter to have a green growth than having the just so 20th century brown growth that we had. So it comes in a low-tech version where you release human entrepreneurship with photosynthesis in a world that is full of garbage and resource depletion, and value can be created. And it comes in a high-tech version where people are starting to move money into that area. So why do we have smart green growth? Well, it's profitable today. We have an immensely resource-wasteful economy, and fixing that is profitable today, which companies such as Walmart and IKEA are discovering. Lots of examples on that. Secondly, I'd like to say that continuous today is not just plain stupid, it's much also more expensive. So to put it this way, you know, the Stone Age, we humans came from the Stone Age, and that didn't end because of a lack of stones, right? We found a smarter way of doing stuff. And now we have a petroleum age. Will that end because of there's a lack of oil or the end of oil? No. It will end because we find simply smarter ways of doing stuff. And smart investors are doing this. They're discovering that this is the biggest business opportunity in this century, is to provide for the 5 billion urbanites in 2030 all the amenities they want, clothes, food, and energy and transport, without wrecking the planet. So we can do much more with less. And the only word I have to describe that is smart. So smart investors are moving the money, and that company is priced much higher per produced cars than the conventional companies. So what we need are deep stories of transformations, where we take existing cities and rebuild them, just as we heard from New York, as we heard from the neighborhoods in Massachusetts. Smart houses, electric cars, biomass, smart houses, using multi-energy ways of combining these, not a silver bullet, but we transform these cities effectively and smartly to make more human well-being, at the same time taking down the ecological footprint. We can tell this story from an economic point of view. We can also tell it from a human potential point of view, where we have human well-being in the focus. We can also tell it from a religious point of view, as the Pope has been doing, shifting from the story of dominion to a story of stewardship. And we can do it from a nature point of view, where we do rewilding. Rather than misusing nature, we can bring back the intelligence of the ecosystems, that it let work along with the flow of the intelligence, the animals, of the ocean, of the corals, and then find new ways of making cities that do not destroy the landscape, but actually enhance them. So, to sum up, are humans inevitably short-term? My starting question. What we do know is that rational information is not sufficient to create lasting engagement or make people behave for the long term. What we do know is that humans need culture. We need social norms, supportive framings, simple actions we can do, meaningful stories that create a sense of cohesion and community, and we need signals that tell us that we are bending the curve. Finally, individual actions do not solve the climate problem. So we're not recommending individual psychological action to solve the problem, but to create bottom-up support for structural change. That is my conclusion. Thank you.
The way that this has all been characterized, you address the climate issue and you lose jobs. There's a lot of money behind that message, and how can people who think otherwise fight that?
Always going on the offensive with your framing, never on the defensive. So you will never say that it's not costly. You will say it is much smarter to create more value with wasting less resources. And by the way, you will then be employing more hands because people are better at handling resources than machines are in general. So more jobs, more value creation with less resource use. That's the framing you go on the offensive with.
Okay. All right. Is this as good as the polar bear, though, you think?
I won't answer that one.
Yeah, all right, all right. We'll figure it out. All right, so Michelle DePass is the, she's the dean of the Milano School of International Affairs, has some background at the EPA, and has deep roots in the environmental movement, and she is going to help us also find new ways to tell this story of climate change in a very engaging way. Michelle, welcome.
Hey. Oh, yes, what do I press?
Luddite.
Well, there we go. See, it's not my problem. It's not my fault. Good afternoon, everybody. How are you? So, how are you?
Great.
Yes. No, I know. This is I'm the second to last speaker at the end of the day. So, I want to thank WGBH for inviting me here. And I've really enjoyed spending time listening to my fellow panelists and learning. I mean, that's what today is about. It's about learning. So, Perez, you gave the challenge of 3-1 in terms of the framing, in terms of you know, the opportunity versus the negativity. So I think actually I have that balance. But so let me start. But I did have the balance of 2-1. So I'm going to start and just say one quick story. So as I was introduced, I'm the dean of the Milano School of International Affairs, Management, and Urban Policy at the New School. And if you know anything about the New School, it's very different than many of your universities here in Boston. It's a newer school. It's new, very, very, very progressive. It was started at, you know, after a bunch of professors wanted to leave Columbia, and they marched on down and created this institution that was dedicated to the pursuit of learning, particularly for adult populations. But the opportunistic story there is that I'm proud to be at the school that has committed its endowment to divestment and investing in solar technology. And it's the second largest endowment, university endowment, that is committed to such an effort. So go New School. So that's the opportune. Now I go to the less happy story. And I put that slide up there because you know, the conversation I'm going to have with you spans the course of actually my career. And my passions for this work, actually I've worked in local, state, federal government, philanthropy, nonprofit, my friends here from the Hunt Point community and the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance, the passion does, for me, get stoked by a picture like this. And this is a scene of what I confronted, not this actual picture, but a scene very similar to what I confronted when I went on a field visit to Mali, about 6 hours away from Bamako, on a visit to look at obsolete pesticides. And when you are a young person in the environment and you're working in New York and New Jersey on waste issues, and you go to Mali and you see this, and 3 feet away you see young people putting a bucket down into a well, and you ask your guide, who does not have any protective gear, but I had protective gear, they're not going to drink that water, are they? And he looks at me and smiles like, oh, you naive person. It is the only water source that they have. So the commitment, whether or not the opportune story is what may drive you, for me, when I started out in my career in the environmental world, it was that understanding that you cannot escape it. Even if you're working in New Jersey and working on waste issues, and one of the solutions is send it to New Jersey, guess what? Later on in your career, you're going to be working in New Jersey trying to figure out what to do with the waste that you sent over there. And in sub-Saharan Africa, they're grappling with what we're doing here. But really what it is power. The dynamics of power. and the power analysis. When you work with communities, the first thing you do is a power analysis. Whose foot is that that's actually up wherever? Choose. And the power analysis and who has the power is actually, I think, one of the amazing stories around what climate has brought to and with communities. So, amazing scholar Frederick Douglass, these are the words that I live by. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has, and it never will. So, my story is going to take you to the past and then bring you to the future. This is New York City subway. Actually, it's probably half as crowded as an average day, but that is a picture depicting 1995. Communities of color and low-income communities have always been bearing the brunt around transit and transportation systems. Why is that important in climate conversation? Well, 30% of our climate problems comes from transportation. When we're talking about some of the very broad, important things that we can do in terms of energy and climate, we really do have to think about the individual and what's happening with an individual around transit and transportation and energy use. So many of the communities in New York City have the trifecta. They live in communities, in 1995, they lived in communities that did not have good access to public transportation. So our friend here from New York City was talking about the Rockaways, a huge community of color that had very little transportation. Plus, they were impacted by crisscrossing highways all through their communities. The South Bronx. Our wonderful planner of the past, Robert Moses, built a system of crisscrossing highways that then, for the third issue, is impacting tremendously the health of these people that don't have access to public transportation, but have crisscrossing highways to their community. And in New York City, back in that time, you had many people that were paying twice or three times as much for their public transportation needs. This was before what we called the magic metro card, which we'll talk about in a minute, but we had two fare zones. So those that were wealthier and often whiter, that lived in downtown Brooklyn, Manhattan, could hop on the subway, hop off, it was one fare. Those that lived in the Rockaways, parts of Queens, Southeast Queens, where I grew up, had to take a bus, pay for the bus, then get on the subway, pay for the subway. And since environmental justice is about where we live, work, and play, guess what? You often had to drop your kid off at daycare because you didn't have somebody to take care of them. That's an extra fare. So you're talking about six fares a day versus two fares for the average wealthier, as they said, whiter person that lived in other areas in New York. So what did we do? At that point of time, I was executive director of the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance. What did we do? We joined a coalition to sue New York State on transit justice issues, that the actual percentages in terms of how much individuals had to pay in New York City for our fare was much higher compared to the amount that suburban riders had to pay. Their rides were being subsidized to the point of 40%, 50% maybe. And in New York City, ours was only subsidized for 9%. So what did that power do? Well, we had the opportunity to win an injunction for a short period of time. And as they were developing the MetroCard, we were able to communicate, advocate, use the power of communities to say we need a solution that provides equity around transit justice. And that is how the end of two fare zones came about. We have one Metro card, you swipe it, you get on, you get off, you get back on within a certain period of time, and it is one fare. And this is a policy change that impacted millions and millions of people. But it was brought on through the advocacy of communities that were taking their power and saying, we're not going to stand for this anymore. And that, I think, is a frame that we need to be thinking about. Optimism. What's a fair deal? So then I got some power. And I was appointed by the president to be assistant administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency. You would think that when you have that opportunity to go from working with communities day in, day out, to then working at a federal agency that has much of a responsibility on climate, that you would be able to make changes left and right. Well, then this happened. The BP oil spill. And it stopped almost everything in its tracks. The largest environmental disaster in US history, 200 million gallons of oil, 87 days of releases. That was a conundrum that none of us were ready to actually tackle. Nobody within the administration. So I want to talk about the story of community power and how we're going to be ready for the next BP oil spill, or the next Hurricane Katrina, or the next Hurricane Sandy. Because climate is bringing massive devastation to communities on a scale that we have not seen before, and we were not prepared, but communities and their power is starting to get us prepared. So this is Derek Evans. How many people have ever seen or heard of Derek Evans? Oh, okay. Fantastic. Derek Evans is the director of an organization called Turkey Creek Community Initiatives in Gulfport, Mississippi. Derek Evans is one, I chose him, and Derek is the gentleman on the left. I chose Derek as one person of a massive amount of community members who brought power to Washington, D.C. after BP. But I want to tell you just a minute about how that power was actually crystallized. After Hurricane Katrina and Rita, another climate and man-made disaster, a group of community members worked with a group of philanthropic organizations to start an organization called the Gulf Coast Fund for Community Renewal and Ecological Health. That organization, which provided resources, but even more importantly, provided the opportunity to build capacity, structural capacity, in the Gulf Coast region that had not existed hereto before. So you had community members like Derek Evans, who had been fighting Clean Water Act issues for so long before Hurricane Katrina and Rita, had his family and his family home and his community devastated after Hurricane Katrina and Rita. He was empowered after dealing with all of the agencies, and when BP oil spill came, he was on us. He was on us in very, very important ways. Dispersants. That word gives me nightmares because we had to live Marcy has talked about people thinking and saying there are different ways of cleaning, of doing cleanups. Thank you for that, because at the time of the BP oil spill, there was one way, dispersants, and also physically moving the oil off, devastation to wildlife, tourism industry, coastlines. Derek Evans and the communities that were empowered after the after Hurricane Rita and Katrina kept on DOE, the Coast Guards, BP, and EPA to actually prove that dispersants were not another public threat, were not a public health threat. You had all this oil gushing out, and we were spreading around chemicals. And heretofore, the jurisdictional issues had not been really grappled with. But guess what? There is now a dispersant rule going through the federal government. Resources. The Restore Act happened, which said that 80% of the resources that come from civil penalties from BP have to go back to the communities. Why? Because right after BP oil spill, all of the members of the STEPS Coalition and the Gulf Coast Fund were on the doorsteps of the agencies, helping them understand what had happened with resources that went awry for Hurricane Katrina and Rita, and don't let it happen again. Earlier on, you saw the picture of Derek standing in front of a trailer. Derek traveled around for years after Hurricane Rita and Katrina with that trailer, one of the trailers that was contaminated with formaldehyde, by the way, that communities received for people that lost their homes. Will not be peed on was one of his slogans, because they had lived through it in terms of one of your solutions is practically killing us. So record claims, record amounts of money going back to the Gulf Coast region for restoration, new rules on chemicals and dispersants, increased jurisdictional increased jurisdictional work between the agencies in unprecedented disasters that will be happening more and more because of climate. The state, the feds, the local government must be working together. And that was the biggest tabletop exercise you could ever imagine. But it was through the push of the community members that were activated, that had garnered their power after Hurricane Katrina and Rita, that forced the agencies to get their act together and to actually bring lawsuits to put the claim to BP and to not let them back down. And what it really comes to is the power of each individual that is built up over time. Many, many people, when they think about supporting organizations and they think about supporting communities, it's a one-off. But I've been able to see through my career how you can support individuals and support communities, and the next time something happens, they're ready to jump and take the mantle and force the power that is at the table to do the right thing. So I'm 29 seconds. So thank you very much.
All right, so we're going to end with a look at solar power. We've had an awful lot of New Yorkers on the stage, so it's probably a good idea to do something from the left coast. Danny Kennedy is managing director of the California Clean Energy Fund and is going to talk to us about solar power and ways we can tell the story through that technology. Danny, take it away.
Thank you very much. It's a great privilege to be here, and thank you to WGBH for hosting me and for all the speakers before me. It's been a wonderful day, and I feel like it's a good setup to what I'm going to try to share with you. I actually come to this not just as the managing director of this fund. As an entrepreneur the last decade, I built a company called Sungevity, which hopefully some of you know. I think there's a couple of customers in the audience. I did that, and before that did about 20 years telling the world what I was against, which was fossil fuels, rather than what I was for, which is clean energy. So I've done a bit of both and believe we have sort of maximized the story of what the problem is in the last couple decades dealing with climate and energy issues, and we haven't maximized the opportunity and the solution story. So that's what I've really been about. But just to get you rolling, I wanted to ask you a question. Just to see, we talked about jobs, and I do believe this is a narrative that cuts through all time and place. Which of these three create or have created the most jobs in America? Is it the top four, you know, Twitter, Google, Facebook, Apple, the giants of the tech scene? Who thinks it's that? Okay. Who thinks it's the coal power industry that's got the most employees in America? Okay, maybe you know the answer to this question. The solar industry. This is incredibly important in politics and building power through time. And we have to come back to this because the solar industry, as you'll learn, is at less than 1% of electricity supplied in this nation, and yet it already employs more people than the coal industry, which is at about 35% of electricity supplied in this nation, having crashed from about 50%. We shouldn't go back from that realization. So the story I'm going to tell you is the story of my life. Since I was born, we've been riding this very interesting thing called a technology curve. And it's a function of mass production with certain things that they become cheaper and their output becomes cheaper the more you make them. The opposite is true of all other energy systems we've used in history. The more you use them, the more expensive they have become. So this thing called photovoltaics, invented just south of here at Bell Labs in 1954, is a really amazing mousetrap. And the more we make it, the cheaper the thing it produces called electricity becomes. And that has held true and steady for the 50 years history of it. Every doubling, it's dropped about 20-some percent in cost of electricity produced. And that cost curve creates what is called a sunny outlook in The Economist. What do you think the incumbency, shall we say, the vested interests in the energy sector call that? Do you think they call that nirvana, paradise? Do you think they call that a challenge in the sort of way that this intelligent conversation has been held today? You know, crisis and opportunity, like the Chinese kanji. Do you think they think of it as trouble? We're worried about that. Or do you think it's sort of, you know, Mad Max Terradome? This is my favorite graph of all time. This is from a Bernstein study, Sanford Bernstein, you know, the analysts on Wall Street, telling their people that they serve in terms of their investments what's happening to the world of energy. This is a slightly longer view of that curve that I showed you in The Economist of prices coming down of solar electricity. It's streaking from the sky like Deus Ex Machina in this case because the time scale is longer. And then there's all other energy markets which are doing what all other energy markets do, which is they become more expensive the more they're used. Because the more you dig a fossil fuel or a uranium or anything else up, the more expensive it becomes to deal with, both its byproducts or pollution, as well as its scarce fossil fuel inputs or other inputs. So all these other energy markets, measured in dollars per British thermal unit, have become more expensive over time. And all the wealth and power that has accreted through the last century, the 20th century of this dumb technology of steam turbines and internal combustion engines, is dramatically threatened by this line. It's being disrupted. Because all of that, think about the Koch brothers and others, the Saudis, the Australian coal industry, they've done pretty well, right? Riding that curve up, charging you and I for the end products, and charging you more and more each year, which is all they've ever done. That's history of economics. And this thing's coming out of the sky, slicing them in half. And unless you know something different to I, that's not going to change, that's just going to continue. There's no plausible reason. So I actually don't worry about making the impossible possible. I've spent my last decade and will spend whatever I've got left making the plausible inevitable. Because that actually is all we have to do. We have the technology, we know the solution, it works very well, it's cheaper, it employs more people, we just need to get it out there. And so we are, at scale. The story of two hockey sticks that I like, rather than the hockey stick that was made famous by Michael Mann, is the hockey stick of costs coming down through time, and as it went down, the deployment went up. And if you don't recognize the correlation, you're not sort of seeing some important patterns in society. And that is what we're doing. And those costs will continue to come down. I could bore you to death with details about why, but at the silicon level, they'll come down, the cells will come down, the panels will come down, the machine will become cheaper. And then the system will also become cheaper. What I spent the last 10 years building Sungevity to do was to sell it more simply. Simple was one of the key words, to bust through the denial and doom and all the rest of it. Make it affordable by financing it, taking it from CapEx to OpEx. You pay for the electricity as you go rather than buy the electricity up front. Squeezing the cost of the capital, squeezing the soft costs of selling it, installing it, and all the rest. And they're coming down too. The DOE set itself a sunshot goal, an initiative to get solar to $1 a watt. And basically, we're way ahead of target on what they expected us to be. And this curve will continue, and its partner technology set, storage, which is very similar in production and in materials and other scientific elements that go into the technology, is going through basically the same learning curve. Lithium ion was only invented 25 years ago, 24, 25 next year. It has exhibited almost exactly the same reduction in cost per unit of electricity per volume production. Its efficiency, its energy density, all these things get better as we make more of it through time. So we are riding this wave, and hallelujah, baby, let's take it all the way into the clam bake, because it can deliver you the thing we need called electricity and transport without the problem that we've been talking about all day. It's a pretty simple concept. The prices come down, that breaks open new applications for the product, which means there are more products made, which means that the prices come down, which means that it can go to new product categories, which means that they'll be more deployed, which means that the thing will become cheaper. So you think about the cell phone in your pocket. What is really the game changer there? I will give you, the microprocessing power is remarkable. That puppy, as you've probably heard, has more computing power in terms of ones and zero processing than NASA had when we put humans on the moon, right? So the cell phone in your pocket, which you will diss next year for the next edition, which will have an order of magnitude greater computing power. But the thing that really made that possible was the battery inside, because that computer needed power to run it, and there weren't light enough, powerful enough batteries to enable a computer to do all that processing in your pocket at that scale for 6 hours a day. Oh my God, it's only 6 hours. Oh no, there's an 8-hour version. Oh, there's an induction charge version. Oh, next year it'll be a 10, 12, 15-year version, because that curve will hold true through the massive deployment of those batteries. And lo and behold, that's the lithium-ion battery I mentioned was invented just 24 years ago and is disrupting telecommunications and computing. That was a mainframe landline interconnected business, remember? Wires. Do you remember what a phone was? A phone was something tied to the wall. Now a phone is something that your daughter texts constantly on, or at least mine does. She doesn't even know that she can speak through it. She doesn't know how to. But she can do all sorts of data processing. The phone has been disrupted by the battery technology inside it, the battery technology we already have. And guess what? Guess what Tesla's doing? It's taking that same energy storage technology platform and disrupting the thing we know as the car and all vehicular transport completely. And so too aviation, and so too marine transport and many other things. And so this combination of solar plus storage is going to bust the world. Indeed, just last year, we went through an historic moment in America where more solar was installed than any other technology set. You know, the gas number there at the end of the year, we think is wrong, because we don't even count in America the rooftop stuff that my company, SolarCity, all the company brand names that you've heard talk about. The Energy Information Administration doesn't even know how to contemplate distributed generation, so it's not even incorporated into these figures. But the key point is that that curve keeps on driving down, which means adoption keeps on driving up. And solar is fast becoming the largest new addition to the electricity sector in the world, in fact. In this country, the last time I spoke here, I can't remember whether it was 11 or 12, but we were still pretty small beer in terms of solar deployments. since 2010. Remember, this is coming out of the Great Recession and Solyndra in 2012, the negative doomsdaying obfuscating nonsense of the bad guys. We have gone to 26 gigawatts deployed nationwide. We have doubled 3.5 times in that 5-year period. Okay. That's an incredible threshold for a couple of reasons. One is the fun one, which is that we're about to cross 1 million solar roofs in America. This is the distributed generation piece of this, which is where I sit and live and love, which is great. There's about 80 million to do, give or take. That's why my business and our investors are confident we'll go well. We're also about to cross 1% national electricity generation. We're just about there. I think we'll hit the 1 million homes early next year, January or February. My company's done tens of thousands of those, so big, but not that big. When you're at 1%, how far are you on an exponential curve? You're about halfway there. Like, I've been in this industry since we were at 0.007 or whatever it was of electricity generation. You go from 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 to 32 to 64, you're done. 7 doublings. When will we be at 10% of electricity generated in the United States? Will it be in just 5 more years, like the last 5, where we went from 0 to 1%? Will it be 7-8 years? Will it be 10? Will it be 15? The industry association is projecting we'll get there between 25 and 2030, which means it will slow down. And they're projecting that because they think there'll be friction. There'll be setbacks in net metering wars. Massachusetts will reject something. California will claw down some of its support or reverse it, in fact, and add charges to those that are interconnecting solar panels to the grid. There'll be some other reasons that will cause us to slow. I'm not necessarily prescribing to this view. I actually think we'll bust through it. We'll do it in the sort of timeline that we did the last 3 doublings, which was 5 years. This is just 3.5 doublings too, to get to 10%. If you go from 1 to 2 to 4 to 8, you're done 3.5 times. The power of these curves, the story that I want to tell is like Ernest Hemingway's. Have you ever read The Sun Also Rises? The guy that went bankrupt. How did it happen, sir? Gradually and then all of a sudden. That's what's happening in energy. It's changing more in the next 15 years than it has in the 150 years. And that's cars too. Don't doubt that we can do this. If you look, there's a great speech by a guy on the web, Tony Sieber, talking about the disruption coming to automobiles with electrification. And he shows this photo of Fifth Avenue in New York in 1912-ish, and then again in 1927, just 13, 14 years later. And in 1912, it's all horse and buggies and there's one automobile. And then 15 years later, it's all automobiles and there's one horse and buggy. This country has done this before. How many of you have a cell phone? How many of you have a landline? You're not Californians. How many of you didn't have a cell phone at the start of the century? It's pretty amazing how quickly this exponentiality works. One of the problems with framing, the storytelling, is the narrative sayers, the news media, dare I say it, in an audience as august as this, the pundits, the International Energy Agency, the Energy Information Administration, the alphabet soup of agencies that cover this stuff, they don't get it. When do you think they cottoned on to this? I just love this next graph. It's not my favorite ever, it's my second favorite, just because it shows how bad the officialdom are at spotting this trend. When do you think they cottoned on to this? It's a silly question, so I won't bother asking you. I'm just gonna show you. This is the World Energy Outlook, which comes out of the International Energy Agency every couple of years. It actually came out today, I believe, for 2015, so I'm gonna have fun looking at it. I stopped looking at it a few years ago, so I stopped remaking this. But the blue is actually what has happened with photovoltaic deployment worldwide. It's grown rather remarkably from almost nothing at the start of the century to quite remarkable growth. And in 2002, the International Energy Agency, the people we pay to tell us what energy future is going to be like, said it would get this big. And then in 2006, they went, oh, we're wrong, it's going to get a little bit bigger. And then in 2007, they did it again, and they went a little bit higher. But they completely missed it. And that is what is reported, that we're still small and insignificant, Whereas we are now, to repeat, the largest employer in energy in America. We are the largest and most added new capacity to the electricity system in America. Oh, and China, and Japan, and Germany, and soon to be India. We are a world-beating industry in its infancy, perhaps, but we will become teenagers very quickly. We're well getting through the toddler age. And don't worry about whether or not the pundits know it, because the big end of town does. Who's the biggest owner of solar farms and wind farms in America? Anyone? Warren Buffett. This is my next favorite slide, which is a picture of Al Gore earlier this year at Davos telling the great and good of that august gathering about the money. When I was a campaigner, I was always told to follow the money. Guess where the money goes? Has gone pretty systematically. Coal has crashed in this country from the top five coal mining companies in America a decade ago worth $100 billion or more, depending on the day. They're worth less than $1 billion together today. They have fallen 98% in value. All power to New School for taking the right stand, but also for taking the smart stand. Like, yeah, you want to get out of coal because coal is dead. The Stone Age didn't end and the Coal Age didn't end because we ran out of the stuff. The Coal Age is ending now, and America is the first place. In fact, California is the first place that's really made that happen. In fact, we've all known this for longer than we care to think. This is a blurry graph, not my favorite production, but the lines are what's important. The story of electricity since the start of the 21st century. And it is basically a story in which a civilization decided to start turning off bad stuff and turning up good stuff. And every year, that's what we did. Less new additions to the grid, which is what these numbers are, each year went in from the dirty side of the ledger. Whenever any new energy was added, new electricity generating capability was added, less of it was dirty, coal, oil, nukes, gas, more of it was clean. And just if you think this is an insignificant matter, like we've already built the electricity grid in the 20th century, wrong. There are more people today that don't have electricity than there were when Edison came up with like our modern electricity system. So we're going to build out shit tons of electricity, if you'll excuse my French, in the next couple decades. And if you follow the trends, it's pretty clear that it's not coal, oil, nukes, or gas. In fact, in 2012, it stopped being mostly that. And since then, it has been mostly clean, and it will ever forward. That is all she wrote. That is the story of electricity. The only problem I have is, will we do it in time? The good news is, going forward, over 25 years, this is Bloomberg New Energy Finances projections, we think we'll do a ton of it because of the demand for electricity services in mostly Asia. About 54% of it will go into about a dozen countries in Asia. It's a massive amount, 9 terawatts. The US has less than a terawatt. You remember when President Xi stood up with President Obama at the end of last year to sort of juice the Paris process? And he said, President Xi said, I'm going to do my bit. I'm going to build 1,000 gigawatts of wind and solar in the next 15 years. That was the commitment the Chinese made, and they're now enacting through the five-year planning process. We don't have 1,000 gigawatts of anything. Like all of the wind, solar, steam boilers nonsense in America combined is about 960 gigawatts. So they're going to build more than the US electricity grid in China in 15 years with the good stuff. As a commitment. They're a source of solution as much as pollution is my point. And there's an enormous amount of money flowing into this, like trillions and trillions of dollars. We need, in our industry, we need more flow, more consistency, lower cost, reliable capital. But the bottom line is that there's a lot of money coming into it. How it'll break down, according to Bloomberg, is mostly solar, by far and away, about half-half big stuff and little stuff, a lot of wind, and still a lot of fossils. And this is the developed countries, to my point about it doesn't really matter what we do here so much as what happens in Asia and Africa, which is here. And our civilizational duty is simply to kill this. And my confidence is that because the curve here is going to become cheaper, this will become less tenable, less plausible, while this becomes inevitable. And the thing that I'll leave you with is that we may have embarked on that this year. To date, as of September, this is the biggest significant drop-off of coal use on Earth in the history of since the steam boiler was made. We're growing at a lower rate this year. It's a 5% reduction already through the course of the year. Back in the crash, you might have heard the world dropped off coal product consumption a little bit, but that was because economic output turned down. This is because even before the Clean Power Plan kicks in, American coal is on its last legs, and China has basically decided to peak, and Mexico's taken a few points off, and Turkey and Indonesia, even a major exporter, and the countries of the world are actually making this rational choice themselves. It's a story you don't hear very often, but it's the story that we need to hear a lot. It's not to diminish the challenge of what we're against, and we're up against massive vested interests, no doubt, but we do have a lot on our side. Aside from rationality and economics, we do have all the good people fighting the struggle in the streets. It's important to me today that this is actually, for those of you that don't remember, the anniversary of Ken Sarawiwa, who was murdered on November 10th, 2000, and, beg your pardon, 1994, 1995, 20 years, for fighting against fossil fuels in Nigeria, the Ogoni Delta, someone I worked with relatively closely, and this struggle continues, is what he said. This is the struggle of our times. It is one in which we are taking on massive polluters, but we are winning, is the thing that I want to leave you with. As I said, California is a real emblem of that in a lot of ways. It has grown its population. It has grown its economy. It has grown Apple, a company which makes ExxonMobil look small, which has more cash on its balance sheet than the US Treasury. It has grown Google. It has grown the internet. It has grown Tesla, the largest new manufacturer in the automobile sector in decades. It has grown all of these things while reducing its energy use and now mandating into law that it will be 50% renewably powered in just 15 years. And every time it sets one of these markers, it exceeds it by a number of years. So when it set the RPS for 20% renewables, it beat it. When it set 33%, it beat it. It will beat 50%. And its GHG per unit of productivity will continue to go down because we have decoupled from carbon intensity while capturing the genius of humanity and doing it with sunshine. Thank you.
Go ahead and sit down there, Danny. And Per and Michelle, come on back up. Danny, you storage. The devil is in the storage, isn't it? You mentioned lithium ion. Is it, when you really start thinking about, you know, grid level storage to tackle the intermittency issue with solar and wind, we're really a long way from that. And is there a hockey stick there that we're not aware of?
Well, firstly, I don't agree that we're a long way from that. And I think this is one of those things that is just said because it's said. Firstly, as I said, lithium is doing exactly the same curve. And so there's a hockey stick, which is it's now being adopted because it becomes cheaper through time. And that's true of the grid scale stuff as well. I wouldn't necessarily advocate lithium ion as a solution at the grid scale. But there are many storage technologies that work really well and are perfectly applicable and are really well understood and have great economics, like pump storage, for example. So, you know, from Scandinavia to Japan, you know, how do they balance their grid? And I also, not to disagree with your setup, but I just think we use words that are said and then we don't question them, like intermittency. There's no intermittency in solar. Comes up on a very well understood track every day.
Last time I checked, there's nighttime most every day.
So, right, yeah, it that comes would, up that would and be intermittent, goes down. Right, and yeah. So it needs a storage to balance the load, but it's not intermittent. It's very predictable, programmable, shiftable through storage for electricity generation. And take, for example, Japan, which shut off 54 nuclear power plants after Fukushima, right? Here's a country of 100 million people. Shut them down. Just stop it because we don't want another one bomb going off in our neighborhood. And have you heard about lots of blackouts in Japan? Have you heard about an electricity crisis in Japan? No, because they had lots of pump storage and they have a lot of batteries. and they just used what they've got, and it works.
Actually, they started importing a lot of liquid natural gas.
They did. They imported
it's
a lot.
It's not storage that got them through that.
I beg to differ. I'd be happy to.
They have very limited solar and renewable there generally because they invested so much in nuclear. Anyway, so what are we going to say, Per?
I just wanted to jump in and say that, it's, for instance, now in Germany, there are megawatt batteries operational in the grid, and there's also coming pump air storage into old mines, and there's also fluidized technologies in terms of liquid electrolytes that you pass through a battery that's easy to scale up.
Flow batteries
to the megawatt levels.
So. But has anybody scaled them up, is the question?
Yeah, the level of 5 megawatts now.
Mm-hmm. I'm struggling with A, Japan is not small in renewables, and B.
Yes, it is. I know that. I've done stories on this, and I've witnessed it. They lagged in solar and wind over the years because of the investments they put in nuclear. We can discuss this offline. Okay,
yeah, but let's do that because I'd love
you
to
ask me
help
a question.
You.
Yeah, how about you?
If I can, I'm just trying to call you. Well, I'm trying to call you on something which I think is important, which is storage. The way you're talking about it, is an obfuscation that this discussion should be clear about. We have the technology to power the world and our transport systems without fossil fuels. It is done at scale. The Austrian state of Lower Austria is 100% renewable. You can run through the lists, right? It's doable, it's being done. We are told that's nice, it's small, but actually it's small and it's growing very fast and therefore it'll be huge very quickly. Or storage is the next big breakthrough. When storage, like I say, pump storage has been a big part of the Japanese solution and it's 100-year-old technology and there are about 70-year-old dams that they're using to run it. They're just running them more frequently than they did when they used nukes. So we have the technology, and as long as we put up these straw men to say that's not going to happen until this other thing that I heard about from someone, we pretend like we can't make the change, whereas we actually can.
Well, no, I'm just saying, the question was, how quickly will we get to a point where grid-level storage will make this something that can really take care of baseload power?
You just did it again, sorry. Baseload is a fiction built around steam boiling. You don't need baseload. Electricity needs to meet demand. The supply needs to match what people use as loads. Baseload is flooding the field with water to grow a crop, whereas drip irrigation is the intelligent and rational system that we use. So when you have a range of sources, including some intermittent ones like wind and some very regular unknowable ones like solar and storage, you can match supply and demand just in time. That is a network theory that everyone in this room understands. That's how we batch data and cache it and make sure it gets to our search queries in microseconds. That is entirely manageable in the electricity grid too, without baseload. But as long as the journalist asks, how do you do without baseload? The setup is that I must meet baseload. I mustn't. I must meet electricity requirement at the time of use, at a lower cost, more reliably than the alternative. That is what renewable electricity does, hands down.
Just to add, rather than going into the deep technical details of this, I think it's about rebooting, so to speak, a new narrative of progress, where we as a society are able to respond to this. In the previous century, we weren't really aware of the destructiveness of our petroleum system and coal system. Now we are aware, and are we able to just rebuild our economy smartly enough so that we shift it much quicker than we believe today? And that's a narrative. It's not something to be solved by technical discussions based on details today, but it's a narrative that is maybe self-fulfilling and also hugely motivational in the next coming decades. So to me, that narrative will drive the change if we really put our energy and enthusiasm into it.
So Michelle, question for you.
Yes. Yes.
What about, I'm curious, how do you feel about whether there should be some sort of tax on carbon? Do you think that's where we should be headed?
In the U.S.?
Sure, anywhere.
Well, it does matter where you
talk about it. Well, how about we'll start here?
Let's start here. It does, first of all, we can't talk about a tax on carbon coming really in this country because we're not including people, it's not 100% transparent of where that money would go if the tax actually came. And we cannot actually put the tax at amount that would change consumer or corporate behavior. So I'm not really a big fan of the carbon tax here. I've seen in Europe, it is not to the amount that is making a big difference in terms of corporate behavior. And I don't think in our country, with corporate America actually being considered a person, that we would actually put the tax to the place where it would actually make a difference.
So then what's the demand to corporate America?
The demand to corporate America. Well, I like to think about, first of all, the demand to our government, to the people that are regulating corporate America, the people that are responsible to us in terms of everything, in terms of our life, where we live, work, and play. So I have to start with our demand to the government sector. And the demand to the government sector should be to regulate the corporate sector more effectively, unless getting out of the way is going to make the reality that we need possible. There are some corporate entities that are innovating and absolutely understand that it's in their economic best interests to be able to think and act on climate, and then there are others that will never get it unless they are impacted by government regulation.
Per?
Yeah. From a psychological point of view, there's a huge difference whether you call it a tax as such or whether you would call it an earmarked fee, for instance. Willingness to pay among people is much higher if it is seen as an earmarked fee that goes straight back, as you said, what's the money going to be used for? If it goes straight back into clean energy, health investments that relate to the energy industry, transportation. So, and also, for instance, British Columbia is a place, not in the US, but pretty close, that has a carbon tax, and they use it to reduce their income tax. And that was highly contested before, but after they did it, support has grown. At the same time, the economy has gone a little bit in the direction of California with higher GDP growth and lower emissions than the rest of Canada. So depending on how you frame it, you could lose or gain support. But of course, as you say, some part of the American industry will never want to get it. But we're talking about the public in the framing aspect.
Danny, what do you think the chances are of some sort of carbon tax in this country?
I love it. Given the no tax pledge of Grover Nordquist, I personally think it's about how you craft it and sell it, that it should be good policy. As far as I'm concerned, this is a poison. We're killing our children. That's very evident. If we can't ban it, which we can't apparently because we're taking some time to get rid of it in our system, we should tax it to buggery so that we can use the money to do the transitions that are required and take care of the people that will be displaced by that transition.
But you can use regulation. I mean, everybody hears the word regulation and they say, oh, but you can use regulation to innovate. I mean, the Environmental Protection Agency started doing it with the catalytic converter, other things for acid rain. There is that opportunity. And the one time I made the president laugh is when I told him that, you know, we were going to make the EPA a lean, green machine that actually motivated people to spend money. And he said, yeah, you guys are just, everybody thinks that you're job killers. So how's that going to happen?
I think that counts as a humble brag, by the way.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. I mean, when you're talking to the president, you got to be you got to be a little humble. But the issue is that regulation does drive an opportunity for competition in the corporate sector, and I think that we need to use that tool a lot more effectively.
Well, you mentioned, you know, with your experience in the administration, I know that President Obama, in his first Facebook video, did in fact address climate change. You've been inside, you're outside the administration. How would you grade this administration on these issues?
I would grade it very well.
Okay.
Well. today.
Give myself an A.
Today. look at what's been happening. No to Keystone Pipeline. And, you know, that was because of the climate commitment. I was at the agency that, had the power of the Clean Air Act and used the hammer and continually tried to use the hammer. The administration is very different than the Congress. And I know all of the efforts that were used by a variety of agencies and at the behest of the president. So I would give it a very good grading. However, you have to really get in the dirt, the behind the scenes to know that. Because what I would not give the administration a good grading on is how it talks about, up until very recently, how it talked about our climate challenge. Hmm. For several years, sort of in between, the in-between years, it was just not on the radar screen. The opportunities to be able to partner with news entities and agencies and journalists, it just was not happening. And so nobody really knew about the efforts that were happening and that were coming from on high, and we were being thwarted. So it depends on the time and what you're actually talking about, because it's not a monolith.
Washington can be an ugly place, that's for sure. All right, questions. Anybody have questions? Yes, go ahead.
So I think this last part of the conversation really points to one sort of set of voices that's missing right now, and that is conservative voices and the voices of individuals who are most credible to political conservatives in this country. And so we heard early in the day about the importance of meteorologists being able to speak about local impacts and frame local extreme weather events in terms of climate change and weather patterns. And I think the same applies to this conversation. And so when I think about the real risk and the real opportunity in terms of climate action in this country, it's political. So the real risk is that this remains the domain of liberal, extraordinarily talented, well-motivated liberal experts and institutions, foundations, et cetera, and that the real opportunity right now is that there's things shifting on the political right. The real opportunity is military leaders, corporate leaders, not just from solar and wind, but elsewhere, the Pope, evangelical leaders, and a few conservative leaders being able to move on this. And I think it's critically important when we think about these stories to figure out how do those stories get elevated and by whom. So when you spoke about the messaging, which was a fantastic presentation, I kept thinking, the other important piece of this is who's carrying those messages. Mm-hmm. Not just what are the framings, but who is carrying them. And I think it's essential that we begin to also think about that.
I would 100% agree with you. And that is where I think it is important to align and work with the environmental justice community. It is about the tough conversations, and the environmental justice community in this country has been embroiled in the tough conversations ever since the very beginning. I was just at another conference recently where I moderated a conversation between Congressman Bob Inglis and Naomi Klein. And talk about tough conversation. But I think that was where we should be. We should be, after spending, after being Senate confirmed and having to be responsible to a Republican-led Congress, if we do not have conversations and find areas of alignment with Republicans, I do think that we are doomed under the timeline that we're under.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I think that prospect of distributed generation is an issue that goes very well along conservative lines. So it is private property issue, it's a freedom, you get increased freedom as a consumer to choose whether you should buy from a utility or we could sell to each other. If I have extra solar on my roof, why can't I sell to you, etc. So all these things about individual choice, freedom, and independence from utilities are values that could very well come within a conservative agenda.
A couple of fun stories, just try to be upbeat here. Out of the last sort of decade of solar in the States, the Green Tea Party, to this point, one of the best allies in the politics of the State House in various southeastern states has been the Green Tea Party fighting for net metering because it's the right to produce electricity and sell it, sort of thing. And then, you know, another personal experience I've had is that Sungevity, our sort of secret sauce is that we put all the solar sales and customer processes online and over the phone, which massively reduces our costs and so on. And that call center has been largely in California. And as we moved east, we needed something in this time zone. So we looked around a bunch of cities and we ended up in Kansas City, Missouri. And I think it was about this time last year we announced that. And, you know, like we're 200 staff now in Kansas City, like probably one of the fastest growing companies in Kansas City. And it's been remarkable because there's not a market in Missouri to note, of note, there really isn't. But we're selling off to New York, New Jersey and all the other hot states from there. And the sort of the burgers of Kansas City and the governor's office and all the economic development people are just like, what? You do what? You sell solar over the phone, over the internet, and you've employed 200 of our people, and wow. And, you know, sure enough, the opening of what policies would make that happen here is sort of the next conversation. And you know, KCP&L, and we're having a conversation. And, you know, just like fantastic beginnings. And so I think, you know, as this joy spreads, the political opposition to it that's just entrenched reactionary stuff dissipates. And that will be stronger as coal crashes and, you know, those remaining 80,000 miners will go to 40,000 in the next couple years. So there'll be a lot of devastated communities. And then, you know, the oil and gas boys are going through the same sort of shedding of jobs. We can pick them up as we grow to that 10, 20, 30%.
And there's also a dissonance issue here, because if I have solar on my roof, because I have that, I now think climate change is getting more important because I'm acting on it. So behavior drives attitudes more effectively than any science messenger could do. So the more we have electric bikes, the more we have energy efficient, battery-driven buses, the more we have solars on our buildings, the more positive the average mainstream of the public will become. That's a prediction according to cognitive psychology.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions before we wrap up? One in the back there. Can we get a mic back that way?
Just a question about, as you're, you know, we're seeing all this expansion of solar and the huge potential, and Warren Buffett is, you know, the leading investor in alternative energy. Do you see already taking shape a kind of financial infrastructure for, you know, everyday investors, institutional investors? Do you see that growing at the same sort of pace as your business is growing? Is there an investment climate? When I, you know, look at any, you know, CNN money, I don't see that much chatter in the mainstream media about this as, you know, not just some kooky green thing,
right,
but rather this bricks and mortar thing that you could actually make a buck off of.
Yeah, great question. As I said, you know, like the alternative energy is now fossils and nukes. That has been the case for a number of years, and all the forecasts and all the business projections are that will become more extreme. And yet the answer to your question is no, there's not yet a financial infrastructure to it. Like, for example, there just aren't analysts in shops like Bernstein that even track the stocks or understand the private equities coming up behind them. So, you know, that one of the reasons I'm no longer with Sungevity, just to be clear, I'm now running a fund, but it's a tiny little early stage impact investing fund that the Californian state set up 12 years ago out of PG&E settlement money. You know, we need this, what I was calling flow, you know, sizable capital markets, not this arcane tax equity crap that we fight for year in, year out, but, you know, debt. And we need it at a cost that makes sense against the risk-reward profile of the products, which are remarkable. I mean, the thing, I've got a financier friend in Australia that runs the Clean Energy Finance Corporation there, which took carbon tax money for a number of months until the government stopped it with a change of policy, but has $12 billion or something to play with. And he's like, you know, compare a nat gas plant with a wind farm, and it's not a level playing field. It's completely unfair because this robot doesn't stop going, the Duracell bunny. Whereas this one, you know, the natural gas thing, it's variable. It's up and down depending on the oil markets and the gas markets and geopolitics and God knows what. And whereas this one just performs as it said it would perform when it was built for as long as it was warranted. And that's what financiers have learned. So they love the product to invest in, but they don't have the architecture. We need, you know, funds, we need bonds, we need securitizations. I mean, that's just started to happen in America. All this stuff that, you know, financial engineering is like a dirty word, but it's actually key to greasing the skids of this change. It is inevitable. It's gone from plausible to the point of inevitability. It will go faster the more money gets behind it sooner.
Any other questions? One more?
Thank you. This is Juan Camilo Osorio with the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance. It's a question for the panel, but maybe mostly for you, Michelle. What should we expect from Paris? What's realistic? What's fair? I mean, after the People's Climate March, I think that the message was very clear in terms of, you know, who cares about this and how people are ready to take action, right? 400,000 people hitting the streets of New York, not just grassroots groups, environmentalists, labor, academics, et cetera. At the same time, we heard Adam kind of like hint a little bit how, you know, mayoral administrations are beginning to think this is going to be complicated. It's not, you know, straightforward. What's fair? Mm-hmm. What should success look like?
I was talking about that a little earlier today. It's always going to be complicated because it's 187 countries negotiating to come to one set of agreements. And so what is fair is to expect that the cooperation between countries is increasing. And it really is the cooperation between countries, like the bilateral commitments and also the commitments with the business sector, that is the most important element. And I'm hoping that there will be a lot of information that comes back to be able to get, because it is the message. If we're just hearing back here in the US, oh, climate talks, you know, there will not be one international agreement, then it's going to be a downfall here in terms of our optimism around climate. But if the stories of the business sector, the mayors and the 2030 commitment, the local initiatives, the energy that came out from the climate summit, that is being carried by delegates, particularly from the global south. If those are the stories that are told, and it doesn't concentrate on the fact that the global south wants a pool of money, wants a huge fund, that there is no country that can actually sit at the table to accumulate, and particularly the United States, so the Congress will never sign on to that. But if we're actually getting the stories about all the different work that's happening with a variety of sectors, that is the important thing. I think that there will be an accord. I mean, there will be an accord and some sort of agreement to be able to keep talking and keep working on this. But it really is the incremental story of what, there's a very powerful story actually that we can bring to the table from Copenhagen, and that is the opening up of the opportunity versus it just being a negotiation, an international negotiation.
I think there is this swell of bottom-up activity that needs to continue swelling as the work goes on. And at that point, when national politicians actually see it's in their own self-interest to have a top-down solution, then it will come. But we need to build that bottom-up momentum to enable a top-down solution.
One more question here in the middle.
Just listening to NPR's story this morning about a Brazilian state senator who's kind of a cowboy, very wealthy. He's deforesting and converting his lands, his probably incredible amount of land, into cattle farming. And it was a great story. And they finally tracked this guy down who's very flamboyant. He dresses like a cowboy, even though he's a very wealthy man. And he was just so hard-hitting against the US that had already deforested, already had developed themselves, and now they want Brazil to basically pay for the problem that they created. I mean, it was really bam, bam, bam. Mm-hmm. It was a really tough story, and I thought of Paris, and I thought, interesting. Is there a rift here between people that already made their bucks, like us, and the industrialized countries that have already gotten there and are holier than thou? and countries like Brazil who are trying to make a buck and develop themselves, and they're ahead of us in some respects, but they're behind in other respects. I don't know. What do you say to them?
Well, yes, there is a huge rift. And then you have, in past COPs, you had China, who still is considered, in terms of international negotiations, a developing nation, of which we owe, you know, trillions of dollars to, and can build entire cities in a year if they so choose. So that's the moment. The moment when I was sitting in Copenhagen as a U.S. delegate, and you know, you hear "lead or get out of the way," and I strongly believe that the president was always convinced that he wanted to lead and wanted to lead and is leading now. So you have more leverage in response to that conversation. And again, even if you have he sounds like a gaucho from gaucho senator from Brazil, you can't really argue with the facts. It is true. We, the U.S., industrialized, and in Europe industrialized on the backs of coal, but we are doing better now. So you just have to keep the facts on the table and be able to bring examples, which I think we're going to be able to Paris.
I just add, I think there's some fun bridges that are already built, south-south and south-north, that are really being productive. And what I'm looking from Paris is not some big answer and top-down solution, but these things from the bottom up. And the bottom up may be country to country or corporations within countries collaborating with others. So in my world, for example, there's an alliance to be announced around massive solar promotion, which is being led by India, you know, and whatever you think of Modi, he's going all in on this stuff. He's trying to get 200 gigs of PV in place in the next decade or so, sort of almost on par with the Chinese commitments. Well, not quite, but very big. So, you know, like, we're now being led and beaten in terms of deployments and dollars spent and R&D and all the rest of it in a technology built and championed here first by China and India. And they're going to sort of form this alliance with French, as the president of the conference, kind of hosting with Francophone Africa and with other tropical countries, basically a big commitment to a massive solar deployment, which, you know, will make these numbers I've talked about in the last decade look tiny when you start activating those economies. Brazil's always got its gaucho senators, sort of like the US, but I think some of the big guys are moving on.
Building on that, I mean, it's quite easy to write cynical op-eds and critics of this top-down process that has spent 25 years almost getting nowhere. And that cynicism has a psychological cost. So if I could come with any kind of recommendation or hope, that would be to report and write much more on the bottom-up swelling of all these opportunities and initiatives happening all over the place. That's why I really also loved the previous panel with all the city stuff happening with Newark and the others, because cities are moving all over the world. And I think one message to also bring that home to a conservative audience is that unless American industry jumps onto the resource productivity and renewables bandwagon, then both European and Asian companies in particular will outrun American industry, which has a so cheap energy base and so cheap resources that you lag behind.
All right, I think we'll leave it at that. Thank you, three of you and all the other people who spoke today. We appreciate it. We want to thank the Candida Fund. Diane Ives, are you in the audience? Anyway, we thank her in absentia. I want to thank Linda Herrer, Carolyn Gallmeyer, Caroline Lee for all the hard work they put in making this. Stand up and take a bow, Linda. Give her a round of applause. Kind of humble on that. And thanks to all of you for being here, for coming here. And if you want to replay any of this, this will be all posted on the web. You'll get an email from Linda explaining how to do that. So, on to Paris we go. We might as well go.
Let's go. Go early.
And
thank you.
Not so bad. Actually, why don't we just go out to the lobby and have a drink or something? Get your parking ticket validated at the door. Oh yeah, you have to do it like right before you leave, or it expires, and that's kind of annoying. So right as you go out the door, get your ticket validated. Thank you all for being here. We enjoyed the day.